Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like you to meet Ms. Eva Olson.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Everybody okay?
Yes.
Great. It's good to be here. It's a great privilege. Believe me when I say that. 61 years ago, I wasn't that privileged. I lived in a hole in the ground. Now, if you wonder why, at 81, I traveled about 36,000 kilometers to schools, churches, universities, colleges, the United Nations, the military, the Air Force Base, because it's very important that I bring some awareness to this generation about what happened in the past and what we can do so that it doesn't happen again. It seems to me that history is repeating itself because we refuse to learn from history. Now, bullying had become a global issue. It's a pastime for some young people and some not so young. I have over 7,000 letters from students and educators. And what they write to me isn't very pretty. One student wrote to me from a Catholic high school. He said, "I can relate to your pain. I know what it feels like to be pushed around and bullied for no other reason than my skin color is different. Canadian African boy, 15-year-old. Do we have the right to judge someone because they have a different skin color or different origin? Or different religion? We don't. My being Jewish should not have an effect on your life. The only thing that affects all of us, that is our own attitude towards others. Attitude. Because our attitude, the attitude we have chosen, will determine our success. And I don't mean in business, or how successful you are, how big a house you're going to live in, or how big a car you're going to drive. Being successful as a human being, how we treat each other. That's success. It's okay to look different. It is okay to be different. It's when we are indifferent towards our brothers and sisters, that's not okay. My grandson was also bullied when he was in grade 10. As a student found out that he was his grandmother was a Holocaust survivor. So in the hallway was the teacher, my grandson, and the bully. He decided for kicks to call my grandson a stupid Jew. What bothered him more than anything, that the teacher was standing there, he said nothing, and he did nothing. So what was the message that that teacher gave the bully? That this kind of behavior is acceptable? Never. And besides, there are no innocent bystanders. That teacher had a responsibility to his students, to his community, and the profession that he has chosen as an educator. And above all, he had a responsibility as a human being. But he chose to be a bystander. I asked my grandson, did you go to the principal? Because there was no point in going to the teacher, because he was standing there. He said he didn't. He went to the newspaper and wrote a letter to the editor, and they published it. He calls it prejudice spreads like a disease. And what he's asking you to do, to help him to wipe out that disease from spreading any further. You have the power to do it. By being one that can make a difference, and you can. The choices are yours. Don't be a bystander. My son is a vice principal at a high school. How was he bullied? The swastikas were painted outside on the school building. And last year, before graduation in June, the swastikas were inside the school building. And what was written underneath my son's name, you effing Jew, you're gonna burn in hell. My family did burn in hell, all of them, except one sister that survived with me. Think about that. How many bystanders were there? And didn't do anything. They chose to be bystanders. And as I said, bystanders are not innocent. If you don't do something about the bullying that's going on, not just in Canada, globally, we are going back the way it used to be in Europe. At a time when I was only 4 years of age, in 1928, there were 300 Nazi bullies. By 1933, there were 300,000. Now, wouldn't it have been easier to deal with the 300 rather than wait till there are 300,000? And that applies to today. If you see someone hurt somebody, don't walk away or pretend you haven't seen it or you haven't heard it. Do something. We can't afford to wait till we have gangs with knives. Please, don't be a bystander. I was also bullied by the Nazi bullies. Now, when I speak of Nazis, I don't just speak of the German Nazis, because every German was not a Nazi, and every Nazi was not a German. The war started in 1939, and what went through my mind then, the war will be over soon. The war wasn't over soon, and Poland wasn't far away from Hungary, where I was born. In fact, the war lasted 6 years, and in those 6 years, 6 million Jewish people were annihilated, and 5 million that were not. Lots of good people from every religious background. March the 19th, Germany occupied Hungary, where I was born. There was no war between Hungary and Germany because they were allies and they just walked in overnight. 13,000 Jewish people lived in my hometown and 11,000 more were forced in from the surrounding villages. So now there are 24,000 people locked up in a ghetto. I was raised in a very poor family. We lived in two rooms, we had no hydro, and we had no indoor plumbing. And that was okay. It was okay to be poor. But we had to take in another family that came in from the villages, a family of five. And now there is 19 of us in two rooms, sharing one outdoor privy for 19 people. And where do you think we slept? On the wooden floors. There were no blankets. I never saw a sleeping bag till I came to Canada. But it was still okay, because I had a mother and a father, two brothers, two sisters, five little nieces, and a grandfather I adored. But not for long. May the 15th, a man came in the square with a drum, beating away at it so everybody would go inside to hear what he had to read from a piece of paper. Pack your bags. You have 2 hours. You're being shipped to Germany to work in a brick factory. We believed them. We packed our bags. We lined up outside. And they marched us to the railway station 7 kilometers away. And God be with you if you slow down. Because they clubbed us, boxcars, between 80 and 110 were packed into these boxcars like sardines in a can, standing room only. Two pairs were waiting there, one had water in it, and the other pair was to be used as a toilet. Now, one pail of water doesn't last very long, now, does it? There was very little air coming into these boxcars. People started to die from lack of oxygen. People were praying, and people were crying. I see the images of my mom. As she found the corner where she squatted down, hugging three of her grandchildren that were orphans. My oldest sister, Sarah, died in January that year, and she left three little girls behind. I asked my mom, why are you crying? She said, I'm not crying for me. I'm crying for all of the children. I have lived, she said. She was 49. May the 19th, we arrived to our destination. But it wasn't Germany. They said they'd taken us to Germany. It was Poland, Auschwitz. As these cattle cars were unbolted from the outside, some people had a sigh of relief. Now we're going to have water and fresh air. For us, there was no water. Anybody that called for water was immediately clubbed by the bullies. The air that hit us was nauseating. Black smoke coming out of chimneys. High towers with machine guns. Electric fences. Guards everywhere with rifles and German shepherd dogs. And chaos at the platform. At that point, I asked my mom, where do we work here? This doesn't look like a brick factory. It was a killing factory, not a big factory. I held the hand of my oldest niece. She was 3 and a half. When Sarah died, I made a commitment when I get married, I will raise her as my own. Little did I know at that point that this will never happen. A prisoner came over and he whispered to me, "Give the child to an older woman." That would have been my mom. She had a 1-year-old grandchild on her arm, and the 2-year-old Kathy was hanging on to her skirt. Beside my sister was my sister-in-law with a 2-month-old baby. I had another sister, she had a 6-month-old baby. I didn't let go of Judy's hand, not until that prisoner came back the 3rd time. And then I said to my mom, "These guys know something that we don't know." And wasn't that the truth? A couple of days later I found out, had I not let go of Judy's hand, I wouldn't be standing here today. I would have gone where most of my family went, except I didn't know where they were going, not then. The men had to line up separately, and the women had moving forward. As you can read there, the Hungarian Jews are lining up for a selection process. Well, I'm a Hungarian Jew. And as we came to the gate, that's where the angel of death was standing, Dr. Joseph Mengele. He didn't speak to us. He just pointed in the direction he wanted us to go, left or right. What does that mean? They didn't tell us what it meant to him. That's how he decided who will live or who shall die. Women and children were ordered to the left. My youngest sister was beside me, she was 17, and other young women, healthy-looking young women, were ordered to the right. By the time I turned my head to the left, I didn't see my mom or any other member of my family. Women and children being separated. Now, why were they separated? The next slide will show you why they were separated. They were waiting to be taken to the gas chamber. You see that little girl with a white coat? Have a good look at her face. And ask yourself, what was her crime? What was her crime to be waiting to be taken to the gas chamber? A 1.5 million children were brutally, systematically annihilated by the Nazi bullies. Children under the age of 12. As we were moving towards the field, it hit me because I didn't say goodbye to my mom. And I didn't tell her how much I love her. Then I remember when I was in my early and mid-teens. And when my mom wouldn't let me go somewhere or do something because they were very religious and our lives were restricted. I used to go to bed crying. But that moment, how I wished that I could have told my mom that I was sorry. But it was too late. For me, it was too late then. I never saw her again. And going to bed angry and crying because you couldn't go somewhere didn't solve anything. We can never resolve any issues by crying or being angry. We can only talk about it, and that's what can help, a dialogue. It's okay to say, I don't agree with your statement, but I love you anyway. I was deprived of that. If any of you have ever experienced anything like this, I can only ask you, do yourself a favor. Don't go to bed angry. When you're an adult, older, you'll be glad you didn't. Talk to your mom or dad. Say how you feel. I couldn't anymore. As we came out to the field, there were half a dozen Nazi bullies waiting, ordering us to take our clothes off. It was a nude inspection. They didn't tell us why, but they viewed our bodies to see if it was healthy. Those young women that passed this nude selection were taken into the bathhouse. And in the bathhouse, there were young female prisoners from Austria, Czechoslovakia, and Poland since 1942. And they did the dirty work for the Gestapo. They shaved their hair off. The group that I was with were not allowed to keep our shoes or socks. We were given wooden clogs. No underwear, a gray prison dress, and a gray blanket. They took us to the Hungarian women's camp. So we're lining up for our daily ration. One piece of bread, 70% sawdust. One metal mug of potato peel soup like water and one black coffee, and that was for the day. In the barrack, there were prisoners from the other countries. Four of those prisoners were supervisors. I asked one of them, when are we going to see your family? This is what she said. Are you crazy? You're never going to see your mother or father, or your grandparents, or if you had a little brother or sister. She pointed out to the chimneys. And she said, you see that smoke coming out of them? You smell it? That's where he went. Did I believe her? No. Sorry. And then, yeah. At that point, I was 19 and a half. I could not believe that I was part of the same race. The human race. Who could do this? You couldn't call them animals, because most animals only kill when they're hungry. And then they run away till they're hungry again. So what kind of people are they? Evil. Sheer evil. Then we found out about the gas chambers. Between 800 and 1,000 human beings were forced into these gas chambers, screaming and moaning. And after 20 minutes, it was silent. It was dead silent. It took 20 minutes for powder Zyklon B to finish them. When they unlocked the doors, they found the children were always in the bottom of the pile with their heads crushed. because their adult bodies fell on them. And as you can see, our hair was cut off in the bathhouse. But when these women were pulled out of the gas chamber, their hair was cut off. Now why would they cut off that woman's hair? Because tons of human hair were shipped to Germany to manufacture felt and socks for the U-boat soldiers. For those that had gold teeth, it was pulled out. If a wedding band didn't come off the finger came off with it. And after them came the crematoria, the ovens. And that's what we smelled, day and night, human flesh burning, our family's flesh. Every morning, 4:30, it was roll call. It didn't matter what the weather was like outside. You had to go outside at 4:30 and stand like a soldier for 2 hours before they gave you that daily ration. One day they ordered 2 prisoners to go to the kitchen, and I was one of them, to bring the soup. And when we got back, one of the supervisors asked, "Did you bring surprise soup today?" What was the surprise soup? It had tufts of human hair in it and bones. On our way to the kitchen one day, we noticed a small camp that was wired off. My sister, no, my other partner, my other prisoner helper to bring the soup, were heading towards the fence. The supervisor stopped us immediately. When we were only going to ask questions, because there were children inside that camp and young adults, she said, "In Auschwitz you don't ask questions and you don't cry or you're dead." That camp of Dr. Joseph Mengele's experiment hospital, where they experimented on 4,000 twins, Gypsy children, Jewish children, children from Jehovah's Witnesses, and others. 4,000 twins. Despicable surgery they did there. Some of those twins were sewn together back to back to see how long they can survive. They were injected with tuberculosis and other viruses. Approximately 148 survived out of the 4,000. Now for those students that would like to know more about Dr. Joseph Mengele's Experiment Hospital, you can click in on the website, The Alphabet of Auschwitz. It's easy to find. And there you will find out what happened, what their activities were, and what these twins had to go through. Beyond description. One day they ordered us to go outside in the afternoon. They told us we're about to receive the tattoo on the arm. We never got it, not that group. Because before they started with this procedure, a half a dozen German civilians arrived, businessmen, and started to view these young women that originally went through the new selection. The isolated 2,000, my sister and I were among them. Now, we didn't know why we were being isolated. But they told us we had to go to the bathhouse to have a shower. And while we were waiting for our turn to get into the bathhouse, we saw human cargo sitting on the tracks. There was a truck parked there. Male prisoners standing by and guards. The prisoner's job was, as these people stepped out of the boxcar, to lift them up and thrown him on the truck. Like you pick up a piece of firewood and you throw it on top of each other. But this wasn't firewood. They were men, women, and children of all ages and all conditions. They were heading for the gas chamber. 12,000 a day. Adolf Eichmann was in charge of the Hungarian Jews, and he was in a hurry to get rid of them because the Russian front was moving in closer to Hungary. Before the truck took off, I noticed an elderly man standing in the middle of the truck. He reminded me of my grandfather. He was in his 70s. He was praying. He was calling for God. Some prisoners felt let down because God didn't send them help. Now how could he? He didn't build Auschwitz. God didn't build Auschwitz and 339 other camps. Evil men did, not God. All we really needed to ask, where was man? Where was man? They turned their head the other way. They became bystanders. And watched while the mountains, the ashes were mounting in Auschwitz-Birkenau. Children's shoes and eyeglasses. The following day, they took us away to Germany, where slave labor began. And before I share with you that part of my journey, I'd like to show a few slides. Last year, a student's mother emailed me. She told me that the Romanian government had announced that the Holocaust didn't happen there. After 60 years, they decided to deny it. I am part Romanian. My father was Romanian. My grandfather, my great-grandfather, they were all Romanian Jews, and they all perished. Now what you see behind me, Romanian Jews boarding a death train. And what is a death train? A train that has no destination. It just goes up and down the tracks till the people inside it perish in a sealed boxcar with no water. Have a look at the man to my left with a cap on, hanging on to the boxcar. Sole survivor in that boxcar is the man with the cap. Now those pictures don't lie. I didn't take them. Every one of those pictures and many thousand more that you can see on the websites were all taken by the Nazis. They were very proud of what they did, so they recorded everything. And the next country, the country where I was born, they were Nazis, they had a different title. And that's what I said in the beginning. Every German was not a Nazi, and every Nazi was not a German. Hitler could not have done what he did without the help of those Eastern European countries and some countries along the Baltic Sea. The Ukrainian police shooting women and children. This wasn't the German Nazis, the Ukrainian Nazis. And the next one. The point I'm trying to make here We cannot take a nation and judges. We can't. Because in every one of those countries, there were good people that also suffered. But there were those that were collaborators and helped the Nazi regime to commit genocide. When we arrived in Germany, where slave labor began for these 2,000 young women, they took us to a city called Düsseldorf, and they put us in pop tents, but not the kind of tents you're used to here in Canada. These tents didn't have a sewn-in floor, nothing. There wasn't grass grown there, so all we had to lie on is clay. Oh, we had a choice though. You can take the blanket that we had, put it on the ground for the nighttime, or you cover yourself with it. Now what happened if it rained all night? Can you imagine what happened when it rained all night? At 4:30 in the morning, you had to get out of those tents and stand for 2 hours soaking wet. Then they marched us down to the river where freight ships used to come in, and we had to unload bricks and pile them up high along the banks. A few weeks later, another selection by German businessman. 520 prisoners were taken. My sister and I were among them. And they took us to the capital of the Rhine, Essen. There we worked for the Krupp manufacturer that manufactured ammunition and aeroplanes. So now the living conditions are better, because we had a sub-camp, barracks and bunks. There was a kitchen there and there was water, but not for long. The Allies had been bombing heavily, but now in 1944, they were also bombing during the daytime, not just at night. If the siren came, and we were on the road, we had to halt. One day we halted near the sidewalk. That face of a little boy I will always remember, as he was calling his mom, "Come and see, the idiots are coming." I have never seen an idiot. I've seen disabled people, but not an idiot. Neither did he. The point I'm trying to make here, that child took with him to the street what he heard in his environment. Never ever is a child born racist. Never. Racism in any form is a learned attitude. So who is responsible for our children's attitude? The teachers? No. We are parents. We are responsible for our children's attitude. Because children breathe the air that we provide for them. And that's what they take with them out to the street, out to the schools. The third week of October, as we got back one evening to the camp, we had a big surprise. Everything had burned to the ground. The Allies that they had thrown phosphorus bombs, small little bombs, as they fall, they ignite and spread like wildfire. No barracks, no bunks, no kitchen, no water. But plenty of fear, because they didn't know what they were going to do with us. Maybe they take us out in the field behind the coal mine and they will shoot us. But that's not what they did. They put us in a hole in the ground A root cellar where they used to store vegetables, root vegetables. Carrots, potatoes, turnip, parsnip, and even cabbage on straw. The part of this root cellar was originally underneath the kitchen, and the other part was outside, like a hump with grass growing over it. It had a trap door, but the trap door burned down because it was made out of wood. What happened down there? The straw started to rot. But not just from the condensation, from the urine, because these young female prisoners didn't go outside after it got dark, out of fear. By that time, we were familiar of those Nazi bullies' pastime activities, rape, whatever they needed to do during the night, they did it down on the straw. And our lights started to appear on the scene. It's winter. It's already 1945. There's snow on the ground. We're still going to work with blisters on our feet because we had no socks. A wet blanket. A prison dress that never came off our body from the time it was put on in the bathhouse. We have no water to wash ourselves since October, and we had no toilet paper either. We're hearing rumors they're going to take us away because the Russians were coming closer, and the Russians liberated that part of Germany. I'd like to share with you a couple of slides before I finish with my final journey then. These are American soldiers viewing the barrack. That's what they found. Buchenwald, where my father died. At age 47. He died of starvation. A man that was never sick in his life. He died in December of 1944. In the middle of February, they took us to our final journey. Bergen-Belsen, where Anne Frank and her sister died. That camp was built originally to hold 7,000 soldiers. They divided the camp in half, and they put in 60,000 prisoners to die a slow death of starvation, dehydration, and disease. The barrack they put us in, there were no bunks, not a chair, not a table. Everybody was on the floor. Most of them were dead already. The ones that were still breathing were already skeletons, covered with lice, and dysentery was an epidemic. They were too weak to pull themselves outside. They were either sitting or lying in their own waste. There was very little food there, next to nothing, and very little water, if any. I said to my sister, I'm going to go outside and look around. Maybe I find a place that's better. There was no better place there. The ground outside looked like the barrack floor. What I came across was several hills, of course. Some of them were as high as a man can reach. I went to one of them because I wanted to see if I would recognize a face someone that I had known before, but they were beyond recognition. You wouldn't even know they were once human. And every one of them had a name one time. And they were part of a family like you are. What you see behind me is a British soldier boulders in the corpses from the hills into trenches. I saw a young girl about my sister's age. She wasn't walking straight anymore. She was just wobbling from side to side. That's how badly skeleton she was already. Her face looked a little bit familiar. And I went close up to her and I recognized her. That girl lived a block away from where we lived. I was in absolute shock to see the condition she was in. I managed to ask her, "Have you seen anyone of my family?" She said, "Yes." She saw my younger brother. He was 18. In a camp, she said, pushing a cart with other prisoners. And I walked away. But that bothered me for a few days. I decided to go to look for her. But I was too late. She had already died. She died like 400 to 500 died every day. She was the only one that I met in 1 year. And through her, it would have been possible for me to find out, where did my brother die? Where did the bulldozer bulldoze his bones? Or where did the wind blow his ashes? I never found out. By this time, I'm battling with a high fever. I didn't know what was wrong with me. I remembered when we were children at home, and when we had a fever, my mom would wet a towel and put it on our head to bring the fever down. Now what do you do if you have no water? I urinated on a rag, hoping if it cooled me down. But very quickly, I learned something. The body will not give up something that we don't put in. If I had no water or any other fluid, I would not produce any urine either. And that is why I saw so many skeletons like broomsticks. Not just did they die of starvation, but also dehydration and disease. 60,000 died in that camp. This was 6 days before we were liberated, and the Gestapo had given orders, zero supply. What does that mean? Means nothing. That one mug of water down either potato peel soup or turnip peeling was taken away. And there is no water. How do you survive this for 6 days? If you're healthy, if you're well, there's a possibility that you could survive. But most of those prisoners were not well. They were depleted physically, emotionally, and spiritually. You had to be very strong to survive the jungle of Bergen-Belsen. I'm one of the few lucky ones. I had that fight in me. Even though I was near death, lying on the barrack floor, burning up with fever, I used to say, I'm not going to die here. I cannot die. I cannot let the SS defeat me. They have already stripped me of almost everything. My family, my home, food, and human dignity. There was one thing they could not strip me of, and that's what was inside me. The strength of my spirit, of never to give up, never. Once you give up, there is no hope for that tomorrow will be a better day. But you keep your hope alive, and there is always a chance that tomorrow might be a better day. For me, tomorrow came. It was a better day. It was April 15th, 1945. 11 o'clock in the morning, we were liberated by the British and Canadians. Now, I knew I was free then. Only free from being killed. Never, ever free, never, from the memory of it, of such a crime against humanity. When the medical team came in, and those prisoners that were not skeletoned were taken to a tent to be disinfected, and out of that tent, to a building outside Bergen boundaries, they made it into a hospital, and that's where we were treated for typhoid fever and dysentery. 14,000 died after they were liberated. They were beyond medical help. But they died free. Some of us that recovered, the Red Cross arrived from Sweden to give us some advice. One, you go back to the country where you originated, or you stay in Germany in a displacement camp, then somebody's gonna come and find you, if you had someone alive. I didn't want to go back to the country where I originated, and I didn't want to stay in Germany one day longer than I had to. I made the choice for my sister as well, and we went to Sweden through the Red Cross. And that was a very positive choice. Why? There, I regained my faith in humanity by their actions. I knew that hope was alive because there are good people out there. To the Swedish people, it didn't matter what our religion was, our skin color, or shape of eyes. They treated us as their brothers and sisters of the same family, the human family. We're so preoccupied with the different races. My concern is just one race, the human race, and how the human race can survive. That's my concern. The Swedish people didn't tell us what they were going to do. They showed us. Now, what did they show us? Same thing as I'm asking you to show each other. They showed us respect, tolerance with compassion, because that is the only way that humanity can ever survive. Not by hate, not by bullying each other or killing each other. I cannot change the past. I have learned to live in it. But the future lies in your hands. You can make a difference by making a commitment to yourself and to others. By not being a bystander, being one that can make a difference, and that you know that you will leave something positive for the generation to follow you. I cannot do it for you. The choices are yours. Thank you, and have a great day.
Times that were in years long gone are still as clear upon my memory as the numbers on my arm. What will become of all the memories? Are they to scatter with the dust in the breeze? Who will stand before the world knowing what to say when the very last survivor fades away?
When I hold my grandson close to me and his fingers trace the pattern of my tears, he asks me, "Zayda, tell me, why do you cry? What is it that you fear?" Oh, and I tell him, there once was another child who smelled this sweet and felt this warm. But he was taken from before my eyes, and only I remain to mourn. What will become of all the memories? Are they to scatter with the dust in the breeze? And who will stand before a world that now wishes to deny? How will they believe in someone? Never heard the cry.
Never heard the cries.
I can say or do to make things change. Time has a way of passing by so fast. Like a fleeting shadow, no one will recall the faces of the past. What will become of all the memories? Are they to scatter with the dust in the breeze? Yet one thought gives me comfort. It's all that I have left. For I know that God in heaven won't forget.